Major funding for Charlie Rose is provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose is also made possible by these funders.
Broadcast tonight, an update on the breast cancer epidemic in light of the recent research controversy. Also, actor Richard Harris and conductor Kurt Masur of the New York Philharmonic. We begin with breast cancer. It is the leading cause of death in women aged 35 to 50, and 1 in 9 American women can expect to confront this often devastating illness over the course of her lifetime. Now, questions are being raised about two of the most important studies of the disease. Joining me now are two doctors and two women who've survived breast cancer. Dr. Allison Estabrook, Chief of Breast Surgery at the Columbia Presbyterian Medical Center in New York, and Dr. Annette Brown, a radiologist and spokesperson for the American Cancer Society. Joyce Wadler, journalist and author of My Breast, and artist and breast cancer activist Matuschka, who's won the Rachel Carson Award for her work in breast cancer awareness. I thank you all for coming. Let me begin with this recent controversy. It continues. Today's New York Times, the New York Times for Wednesday, March 16th, flawed cancer study haunts many women, experts to review study conclusions. Help us understand what we make of this recent controversy.
I think there's a few issues involved here. The first thing is we're not going to be changing our recommendations for doing lumpectomies. And women who are eligible to have a lumpectomy, we will not change the recommendations based on this falsified data. So that's the first thing I think that should be made clear. The reason for that is that other studies done in basically in Milan have substantiated the findings by Dr. Fisher. The other things that are involved in this are the fact that very few women go on protocol studies, that it's difficult to become involved in a study when you are when your doctor is telling you you can either have a lumpectomy or a mastectomy. We're not going to know which one you're going to have. You're going to be randomized to either group. That's very difficult, and I think maybe impossible to do 10 years from the time the study was done. So the study was done about 10 years ago. So he had to use about 450 institutions, 5,000 doctors, to enroll enough women to get a statistical significant data from this study. And I think that he can't review all of these doctors. He can't review everything that's been going on. And that poses a problem for huge studies which need to be done like this.
I'd love to have all of you just react to this, because, I mean, I've talked to some people and I've watched them on television. I've read stories about them. I mean, and it confronts two issues. One, what do you believe and who do you believe and where we go from here? What was your reaction about
this? Well, my reaction was it's very important to look at the numbers. There were 400 hospitals involved in the study, and this is one doctor, I think 1,000 doctors, who faked some of the results. So you've got to put it into perspective and not throw out the evidence on lumpectomy.
And there's some danger of doing that, I assume.
Absolutely, because there's such hysteria, and all people here now, and even read the headline in the Times today.
Flawed cancer study haunts many women.
Well, there we go. So nobody is leading, and when I looked at that and said, now what were the statistics again, I saw that very low in the story, so that concerns me. Mm-hmm. I had a lumpectomy, I'm glad I did, and I'll be very frightened if we go back to where we were 15 years ago.
Yeah. The other thing we should mention is that now that we're doing mammography screening in such great numbers and picking up cancers so early, we have better data on which to decide whether or not a woman has a lumpectomy or a mastectomy. So it's not as though any woman is going out there with a 5-centimeter cancer and being told she needs a lumpectomy. So I suspect that most women who have had lumpectomies have had them for the reasons, for valid reasons. You know, you've considered how aggressive the tumor was, the size of the tumor, the size of the breast, the age of the woman, et cetera, et cetera. I don't think women have any need to panic, those who have had lumpectomies so far.
Well, it's very complicated because they fail to say that a lumpectomy really reduces, has the same survival rate as a mastectomy. But a mastectomy obliterates the fact that you can have a recurrence in that breast, and that's where I got tripped up in my discussion with my doctor. I understood it as if you have a mastectomy, you save your life. It's easier to save your life that you don't have a recurrence. You just don't have a recurrence in that breast. And a lumpectomy, you run the risk of having a recurrence in that breast, but the survival rates have shown throughout Europe and for a long time that it's the same, mastectomy or lumpectomy in early stage 1 and 2 breast cancers. The problem with the press is they will now focus on sensationalizing, I think, the wrong issue here. I don't think he really falsified the data. What he did is, I believe, if I read it correctly, is that he allowed more women into the study against the time frame that you were allowed to be in. But they're probably still valid in the sense that these people are still alive today, and they had the same survival results. But
well, I think it's unclear exactly what he did falsify. He did falsify that. In other words, it's unclear whether these women were actually randomized or whether he did a lumpectomy and then said, well, I had presented her and, you know, I needed another person to have a lumpectomy in this group and she was randomized to a lumpectomy, or actually he just did the lumpectomy. It's unclear whether he really, you know, exactly what he falsified. And also, it says in one of these articles, although we don't know this in the breast cancer community, we haven't heard any direct leaks, but so all of our information is coming basically from the press, that he was reporting on people who have died.
But I think the issue also is, like, even the tamoxifen things, that we do not get the information presented to us on time and in a way that we can make our own judgments.
Why is that?
I'm not sure if it's the drug companies manipulating the doctors or I haven't figured that out, why we're not getting, because they're afraid to scare people, they're afraid to tell us the truth. I think they've been hiding the truth from women for a long time, and, you know, I'm tired of issues and tricks in disguise.
Speaking of that, let me just show this and let's talk about this, because we want to move also to awareness. Having looked, that there's a note from the New York Times today saying federal health officials have commissioned 3 statisticians to analyze independent data from a flawed breast cancer study in the hopes that the reanalysis will assure the public that the original conclusions remain valid, which you believe?
Yes.
Do remain valid.
Definitely.
You know,
I think all of us agree that they're valid.
They don't, right.
I believe them, but frankly, a lot of the time, people just don't give women information. For instance, I did everything right. I had mammograms every year from the time I was 30, and when they found this lump, I always hate to say how big the lump was, because I talk about it a lot, and I feel like every time, you know, it's getting bigger and bigger, and it's like, you know, the size of a watermelon by now, but it was big. It was 2.8 centimeters and missed by mammograms. Now, what I'm furious about is that nobody told us that there was a failure rate for premenopausal women, for women under 50. Some people estimate that failure rate to be as high as 25% or 30%.
Failure to detect.
Failure to detect. Failure to detect. False negatives, right. Now, why didn't they tell us? I have a feeling they didn't tell us because they thought women would use it as an excuse not to have mammograms. And I think we're a little brighter than that. I really think that forewarned is forearmed, and I had a right to know about that false negative. I would have gone to the doctor a little sooner had I known, or if I'd had a bit more information.
I had the same thing. I went for a mammogram 3 years in a row. My mother died of breast cancer. At the age of 24, I was going to the top best breast cancer specialist in the country.
And because you knew of the genetic factor.
They never told me that a mammogram might not show my tumor. And even when they did find a tumor, they told me it was a fibroma and wasn't cancerous. So therefore, when they ended up doing the surgery, they made a mistake in the way they did it. And she made a very interesting point in her book, that even though with a great insurance policy and a standard living, and going, having access to what is the best treatments in New York, and the hospitals and doctors, et cetera, and I, the same thing. I had the best supposed doctor, I had a good insurance policy, and I had enough money to cover my bills. I still was mistreated, misdiagnosed, and had a bad, lousy time with the medical profession here.
Medical profession here. Tell me why this is happening.
I think there's a resistance to doing lumpectomies, and that has been
because so you want to be on the safe side.
Right.
Doctors always now in a world of malpractice and in a world of whatever.
It's not really the malpractice.
No.
It's not the malpractice. It's the life of the patient. We're always worried that that if we don't get all the cancer out, it will recur and the patient will die. And so we are more concerned with at least we are more concerned with proven therapies that mastectomies saved people's lives, and therefore we you know they went with mastectomies.
You shouldn't say that on television. Mastectomies save people's lives because breast cancer is systemic. And by the time it's discovered and your breast has been removed, it's been in your body for 7 or 8 years. And if you can have a recurrence when it's found or have a lumpectomy or mastectomy, it's already spread.
No, I think that's a good point, and that is true. What I'm saying is in the past, when women had mastectomies, there was a survival rate. 100 years ago, the cancers were large. People didn't have mastectomies, or that was too late to have a mastectomy, and people died of breast cancer. Then they start to see cure rates as people had mastectomies. When Halsted did mastectomies, people were living from breast cancer. So they thought at those times that taking out the cancer, taking out the lymph nodes, saved people's lives. Now we know that taking out the cancer and irradiating the breast and taking out the lymph nodes is just as good as a mastectomy. But in those days, they didn't know it. So even in the 1950s, we were saving people's lives by doing mastectomies rather than, there was no choice.
By removing the cancer, you were doing barbaric treatments, and you're lumping people that have possibly had in situ, had encapsulated, right. which is I think your case almost, right. Is that encapsulated cancer hardly ever kills anybody. And they can be very large tumors. They could be the size of plums, but if they're encapsulated, the chances of them leaking out is rarer. And I kind of disagree with that about mastectomies. They reduce the chance of having a recurrence in that breast is what they do.
But you see, the thing is, it's difficult to decide how you will have every woman out there make a decision for how her cancer is going to be treated. I mean, some of us do have the information regarding the disease more than the individual woman would have. She necessarily has to discuss this with her physician to decide how this particular cancer is going to be treated. Not every cancer is equally aggressive. That's not so. I mean, size makes a difference. Spread makes a difference. And size is sometimes related to spread. A smaller lesion, as I said, now that we're doing mammography, and picking up very, very small lesions. The problem is sometimes we don't know how to treat these. Do we need to zap her with radiation? Do we need to put her on chemotherapy? What do we need to do? We're finding these very, very small lesions that we couldn't pick up before. So I see very often in the women's magazines and in the newspapers, everybody has an opinion, and everybody makes a decision as to how something has to be done. And then that becomes the rule. As far as mammography goes and not picking tumors up, people don't understand that it's a test with limitations, like any other test we have for anything else.
Sure, but we
that
don't
is what doctors need to
nobody
describe
told
to
us,
women.
Just like I didn't understand that pain was also a sign of breast cancer. I believed the other thing. One of the great myths, if your breast hurts,
it's not cancer.
It's fine. So if I had known those two things, again, I would have gone in a little earlier. That's my concern. Now about, you know, one rule for everybody, no. Because the bottom line that women have to know is that breast cancer is a disease of options, and every cancer is going to be different. You're going to find, as you say, a lot of different cancers in different stages, and you just can't say, well, it's equal survival, mastectomy, lumpectomy. And finally, there's a very personal thing, which is the decision that's right for me may not be right for you. And the doctors have to share the information, and most importantly, women have to know that they can ask questions, that they have a right to ask questions, that they should ask questions, and they have time. They don't have to make a decision in 24 hours.
Right.
And they should talk to a lot of people and then look at all that information and say, okay, what's right for me?
Okay, let me just stay with that issue. Talk with a lot of people means whom?
Not your girlfriends. I shouldn't say not your girlfriends if they aren't doctors. Because, you know, in New York anyway is a city of experts. You know, most of my friends are journalists, but as soon as I had breast cancer, they were suddenly the heads of the department at Memorial Sloan Kettering. You know, right. They were all very eager to tell me what to do. I said, no. So for me, this was, I was going to get a second opinion with two breast surgeons, an oncologist, two plastic surgeons. I think I ended up seeing three plastic surgeons. But again, I was pretty lucky. I was lucky because I had a breast surgeon who said to me, you do not have to make a decision in 24 hours. And that was great because I changed my decision. When I had this operation, again, it was there was a lump that had been missed by mammography, even by physical examination. And I said, how do I know there's not another one of these things in there? And he said, we don't.
your breasts are a surgeon's nightmare. This is what every girl wants to hear, your breasts are a surgeon's nightmare. He said, you know, they're large, they're dense, they're full of lumps. So of course I said, take it off. But when I'd had a little time, which he encouraged me to take, you know, when I talked to other doctors, when I got opinions and people said, no, you're a perfect candidate for lumpectomy, this cyst is, or this lump, this tumor is encapsulated, it is a non-aggressive tumor. When I realized how complicated breast reconstruction was, I said, uh-uh, not for me. That was finally my decision. I said, I'll live with the possibility of recurrence. That was what was right for me. It might not be best for another woman. I never say to another woman, you must do this because I did this. What I try and encourage other women to do if they call me is say, hey, take a deep breath, kick back, and get some information, because information is power.
Beyond, go ahead.
I think the recurrence, you have to keep remembering that she lives with the possibility of having a recurrence in her, that breast, which is a lot, and yes, she can have a, but she has the same exact level of recurrence for the rest of her body, whether she had a lumpectomy or a mastectomy at her stage. She lives with the possibility of having a recurrence in her body, but she has a little bit more of a chance of a recurrence in her breast because her breast is still there. This recurrence makes everybody nervous. They say, well, you eliminate the chance of a recurrence only in that breast. I think that's got to be clear, because people don't die because they have breast cancer in their breast. They die because of it where it goes.
Actually, you know, I've heard that you can have recurrence even after mastectomy.
Oh, no.
It isn't a guarantee.
Right under the tumor.
Yeah. It's not a guarantee. Yeah. And there's also another statistic which says that you have a 30% increased risk of cancer in the opposite breast. Mm-hmm. So a mastectomy doesn't protect you from cancer forever. Mm-hmm. Neither does a lumpectomy.
Right.
You know, it's a method of treatment if you... It depends on the wishes of the woman, too, and, as I say, on the medical indication for this. My problem sometimes with a lot of this is that I sense that women feel that doctors are intentionally withholding information from them and not giving them the best advice. And I don't think
look at the papers last 2 days that somebody was withholding information from us.
Well, when you think of how many physicians are involved in research out there, if you think Dr. Poisson's
the tamoxifen is indicative
of what physicians do.
No, but there's the tamoxifen trial, which is going on, and how many people knew that 6 women died on tamoxifen already since the early 80s? That information was let out in November. I discovered it just recently. Someone sent me an article about the 6 women who died of uterine cancer after taking tamoxifen. Those doctors that found out about it in November should let all their patients taking tamoxifen know this information, that there is an increase of death, not just uterine cancer, death from uterine cancer by taking tamoxifen. This information should be given to a woman if she wants to decide to go off tamoxifen because she doesn't want to get uterine cancer or run the risk of dying from uterine. That information should be to every woman as soon as the study comes out.
This is absolutely true. I mean, there's really a serious, ethical problem here. If you know that healthy women have a, 30% higher risk of getting uterine cancer, and you're encouraging women to go into a test, that's scary. You have to tell them.
You have to notify everybody who signed up on that trial that as of this year, 6 women have absolutely died from taking this drug. You've got to do that.
Well, do you think that no one who takes tamoxifen knows that the possibility of endometrial cancer
I don't know what they know, because I wasn't there when they...
I haven't heard of anyone knowing this. I mean, I did a lot of speaking in October during Breast Cancer Awareness Month, and there were people telling me, I'm thinking about going, in for this trial. Nobody mentioned that as a concern.
But I see many women for measurement of endometrial thickness because they're in tamoxifen.
And also,
physicians refer them all the time just for that.
When they're recruited into that trial, they go through a whole slide presentation about the trial as well as papers that they have to sign, which say about the risks. And it does.
Does it include that risk?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Well,
it
now
does not
that
include
the women,
the statistic, because that's well, a
that's
new
a pretty important.
That's a pretty important.
Healthy women have died. I want to know that. Thank you. It's like exit taxi. I'm out of there. You know,
it
like,
just
come on,
came out
support.
In November, so I'm sure it includes it now.
Just November. Wait a minute. This is mid-March.
Right.
We've got a big lag.
And they knew it before that, by the way. They've known it for years. The article that I got from the Press Democrat from Indiana, they knew it for years.
The risk of developing endometrial cancer is in there.
But
the
dying from it. They well, knew,
if you, yes,
they knew,
they knew
these women.
If you develop it, of course,
but
you
they
can
don't
die
say
from
that.
It.
What they say is uterine cancer is so easily cured at an early stage, it's much easier to cure than breast cancer. And it's just as far as I know, it's just as hard to detect. You have to keep on doing biopsies to a certain extent. It's not like cervical cancer where you have a test, a pap smear. They don't say, they all they do is say, it's easy to cure if you get uterine cancer.
Let me interrupt and make this couple points here before we continue. One is, this is a New York Times Magazine cover from August of 1993. They got a huge amount of attention. And this is obviously Matuschka. And then this is also part of your own 1991 art. What I want to know is what was the response to this and what is the continuing response to this and what has changed because of the attention that has been drawn to breast cancer and what still needs to be done and what's the message that we want to communicate out there because of this book, My Breast, and because of this magazine cover and because of the conversation that has taken place in response to this one flawed study.
Well, first of all, I think a lot of women are going to be involved with how research protocols are conducted. The actual patients that have gone through this and listened to the myths and distruths, et cetera, are going to have to be involved with helping the scientists and researchers put together more logical protocols, because I think that we are practicing medicine without logic and science, without humanity in this case. This thing about it's nothing to worry about, how many times have you gone to the doctor and told it's nothing to worry about, and then you end up without a breast and bald 6 months later or 2 years later, or dying of breast cancer. I would like to hope that I put breast cancer on the map big time all over the world with my picture, which is, I think, what happened. But I'm not the only one who is out there shouting and demonstrating the National Breast Cancer Coalition.
And do you believe your shouting is being heard?
Oh, absolutely, because they are like this administration, fortunately, is starting to give money towards alternative therapies to look at researching alternatives, since we have really failed with the standard chemotherapy, radiation, and tamox, et cetera. We have not really increased the cure rate with all these barbaric treatments.
Is the medical community hearing, and is the medical community changing in terms of its sensitivity to what's happened over the last?
I think definitely.
And is there a conversation within the medical community about?
About?
Well, the sense of how the outrage that many people have felt, and the sense of not knowing, sense of not being heard.
I think definitely, and I think that a lot of doctors are involved in the National Breast Cancer Coalition group. I think that that we're trying the best we can. We're doing more screening. Mammography has improved greatly. Chemotherapy regimens have improved. We have, on one hand, more screening. On the other hand, autologous bone marrow transplantation. So we're attacking this from both ends. We're doing less surgery than we did 10 years ago, smaller surgery on more people. Now, the thing about the cure rate being the same, the cure rate is the same, but the incidence has gone way up. So therefore, something is happening. If the same number of people are being cured.
You assume that is superior detection, I assume.
Yeah, absolutely. And
sure,
also,
it's superior detection, but yeah. But I'm still worried about this, because if you want to look at the death rate, you know, I had a very good scenario, but why not? I'm a white middle-class girl with great health insurance, and I had access to the best health care in the city. The death rate for black and Hispanic women in this country is 19% higher. That has nothing to do with race. That all comes down to money. They don't have the money for the mammograms. And when I see something like, you know, I went to a breast cancer luncheon and there was, you know, President Clinton's smiling face there telling us how we have the support of the administration. Although I'm a Democrat and I voted for him, I had to laugh, because this is an administration that now says, we don't think we'd like to give you the money for mammograms for women between 40 and 50 unless your doctor recommends it. Well, yes, there's a high failure rate, but also women under 50 account for 26% of the breast cancer cases in this country. So come on, let's get a little support. This administration wants to pay for maybe mammograms for women once every 2 years after 50. Well, if you want women dying, that's wonderful. Go ahead and do that. But I think I'd like my tax dollars to go for health care for everybody. Yeah. I know.
Absolutely.
Not,
on your
let's
side.
Go to the president.
I, mean, I don't
let's
think
go to the
any
White House
doctors are stopping our recommendation of having a mammogram under 50 every 1 to 2 years, depending on your risk factors.
I have a recommendation for myself. I'm not having, and I had breast cancer, I'm not having mammograms every year or every other year, because I don't want the additional incidence of radiation, because they have according to the Montreal statistics in Canada, that it has not helped, and it might even increase your chances of breast cancer. Now, I don't want to scare anybody, but I would rather see the money going towards better diagnostic tools. Let's get better, let's improve the MRI, which does not give you any radiation, and let's bring the cost down of an MRI, which is certainly more accurate for women like me. Okay. And let's go towards prevention and start dealing with treating the healthy, not to get sick, and cleaning up this environment, and looking at the cause of cancer, instead of constantly saying, oh, let's be God and try to figure out how to cure something. We don't even know what the causes are.
I'm sorry. Okay, one last word, Dr. Brown, then I've got it.
Do you have a better method for detecting these tumors? What are you going to do? Would you suggest that other women do the same thing and not have mammograms?
No,
better method of detection is there at the moment that you know of?
Self-examination is extremely useful for women under 50 years old, more than mammograms, I believe.
You're going to miss the smaller tumors.
No,
then.
You're not going to find them.
Well, you missed my small tumor under a centimeter.
Well, they missed my large one, but as far as I know, that
the
Canadian data, as far as I know, was off. It
we
was based on old
about
machinery.
Everything we hear out of Canada from the look of things.
Clearly, the one
Canadian
message
study,
that comes
the
is
Poisson
that
study.
Well, hopefully there's more awareness, and secondly, that more people are asking more questions, and especially those people that are vulnerable.
No, I think women should know that they have to examine their breasts the same time every month, and they should be taught how to examine their breasts either in high school or some program. But it's not just feeling. There's a whole system to doing it.
That protects 18% of the cancer.
Thank you very much, Dr. Annette Brown. Thank you very much, Matuschka. Thank you very much, Dr. Allison Estabrook from Columbia Presbyterian. George Wadler's book is called My Breast. It's in paperback. I thank you very much. We'll be right back. Richard Harris is here, and Kurt Masur from the New York Philharmonic. Back in a moment. A veteran of more than 50 movies, count them, 50, Richard Harris's life has often seemed more cinematic than his films. In the 1950s, he was ranked as a stage actor with Peter O'Toole and Richard Burton. His spectacular performance in This Sporting Life in 1963 made him a film star. But in the following three decades, many feel he squandered his strengths. Now, however, he is back with an acting vengeance. Since his Oscar nomination in 1991 for The Field, he has been in Clint Eastwood's Unforgiven and in this year's Wrestling Ernest Hemingway. Next month, he plays the title role in TNT's miniseries Abraham, and I am very pleased to have him here. Welcome.
Thank you. Abraham has been screened on Easter Sunday, Easter Monday.
Is that right? Yeah, screened, meaning that's when it will be seen on TNT?
Yes, it's finished already.
Yeah.
We finished it.
Now you really got into this understanding who, from biblical scholars, understanding who Abraham was, and this was one of those roles where you...
It was interesting, you know, when they asked me to do it, I having been sort of brought up on the old Hollywood, Cecil B. DeMille, old biblical things that were sort of a lot of old, not very good, right?
Yeah.
And
right.
So I was
made in Hollywood.
Made in Hollywood. I was not particularly interested in doing it. And then all these guys flew in. I was actually in New York at the time, and they flew in from Rome, and they showed me how they were going to do it. The texture of it was going to be really as authentic as possible because we shot in Morocco, and I was quite concerned that the picture would not be Hollywood, would not be Cecil B. DeMille, and it would not be religious. Would not be a religious picture, a spiritual movie rather than a religious movie.
And what's
movie.
The difference?
Well, the difference really being that religion in that particular time, what we call institutionalized religion, hadn't been formed in those days. There were no opinions because that was the era of polytheism. And it was Abraham who actually united to a monotheistic religion. That's when the one God. So therefore, preceding his life or that, a worship of idols, which in a sense wasn't really religious as we call religious, wasn't doctrinated, you know, and that. And there was no dogmas attached to it. It was only latter, and his latter years, when he sort of brought into a monotheistic thing, that it became sort of organized, institutionalized, and so forth.
Now, Jerry Rafshoon is the executive producer of this.
Yes,
I used to know from the Carter years, and
that's
now
right.
Film producer. And I'm heard that he has said that you really did talk to biblical scholars about this.
Oh, yes,
I mean,
we
that
did.
You really,
I did.
You got into,
oh, yeah, very
in a sense,
much.
Researching this
yeah,
kind
very
of
much.
Thing.
But when they told me that there would be biblical scholars representing the Jewish religion, right. the Catholic Church, and also Islam, when they were there on the set, then I said, well, look, if they're there on a daily basis, I'll do it. So it ended up with sort of making it in a strange way by committee, but making it with people who understood it, so we wouldn't offend anybody. It's a subject matter that it can be offensive to one religion or the other. I wanted to make sure that it was not offensive, and again, that it wasn't. And also, what I wanted to do was this. I didn't want to play, normally when people play biblical figures, they either play them as rebels
yeah.
or saints. And I said, I want to do neither. In that.
You wanted to play them as what?
Well, I wanted to play him. I remember when I wanted to play him as an ordinary man that he was. He was a trader. He was a simple man. I wanted to play him as a man not born to greatness, but greatness thrust upon him. And the weight of the responsibility destroyed him. I mean, there's moments in the second half when you almost think Abraham is going slightly mad. The responsibility of it. Always wondering, was it God? Was it the voice of the devil? Was it hallucinations?
Yeah. Now, you do an interesting thing with the voice of, as you hear the voice of God, you don't do some booming voice from outside.
No, I wouldn't do it.
Go ahead.
Yes, I'll tell you what it was. Interesting, Charlie, interesting. I said to them, how are you going to do the voice of God?
Yeah.
And they said, well, that concerns us. I said, no, it's very simple. You're not going to have an Orson Wellesian voice
yeah.
or Charlton Heston voice or Olivier voice. I am the voice of God.
Yes. Listen to me, Abraham.
And they go, no, please don't do that. Echo chambers. Please don't do that. How will we do it? And I said, well, look, I'm a religious person. I'm brought up Catholic, and I've gone in sometimes to monasteries in kind of disturbing times in my life to what we call the Catholic Church's religious retreats. We go to a monastery. I've gone in very often to monasteries, spend time in a cell. And I said, you know, when God, and I said, and God has spoken to me. They all said, what? I said, yes, God spoke to me, but does he speak to me in Aramaic, Italian, Latin? What voice does he use? And I said to one of the people, you're a Catholic, and he was a devout Catholic. Do you speak to God? He said, I pray to God. Does God speak to you? He said, yes. What voice does he use? And the man said, well, it's my own voice. I said, that's it. Because when you meditate, it is your own voice that speaks,
yeah.
right? So I said, it must be Abraham himself's voice, simply done, not done through echo chambers, but the simplistic thing. And the reality of it is that too, because if you pray, it is God. And if God answers you, it's in your own voice.
Let me show a clip of this.
He says, Richard Harris, you are misbehaving. It's my own voice. Oh, yes, I am. It leads to kind of schizophrenia, but there we are a minute.
Well, how often did he say, Richard Harris, you're
misbehaving?
Have you heard that voice say
well,
that many times to you?
Yeah, yes, I do.
Do you change?
No.
Listen, I don't want to, do you want me to show a clip of this or not?
Oh, yes.
All right, here it is. This is Abraham talking to God about the future of Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay, here it is.
My Lord, will you not stay a while longer?
I shall not hide from my friend Abraham, the father of nations, what I am about to do. The outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is great. The sins of which they are accused are very grave. And I will go there to see if they indeed have done according to these outcries.
My Lord, will you destroy the righteous with the wicked? My Lord, suppose 50 righteous are within the city. Will you not spare the whole city for the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from the Lord to do such a thing, to slay the righteous with the wicked.
If I find at Sodom 50 righteous, I will spare the whole city for their sake.
My Lord, I hold the dust and ashes. Should you not ask, but suppose 5 of the 50 are lacking? Will you destroy the whole city for the lack of 5?
I will not destroy it if I find 45 there.
My Lord, be not angry. Suppose 40 are found there.
For the sake of 40, I will not do it.
Suppose 30?
I will not do it if I find 30.
20?
For the sake of 20, I will not destroy it.
My Lord,
My lord, I... may I speak again just this once? Suppose 10.
For 10, I will not destroy it.
What of those that are without guilt?
You've never seen that before?
No.
You liked it?
Yeah, I did.
Good work by the actor?
I think he's good, yeah.
Now, what about wrestling Ernest Hemingway?
Oh!
Mr. Joyce, tell me why you're...
angry.
Well, why?
Well, because it's the best performance that Duval has ever given. He claims that, even better than his Oscar performance in Tender Murphys, Mercies. It's probably one of the two best performances I've ever given, despite the fact I've been nominated twice. I thought this may be a third time. And it's a small film. It's a film that cost like $15-16 million, a small picture. Big, big companies who are concerned, like Warner's, had it. They have five or six huge movies. They opened us up again. Schindler's List, The Fugitive, In Line of Fire, In the Name of the Father, and in the Remains of the Day. Of course we're going to get lost in those 2 weeks. And they understood that beforehand, like Driving Miss Daisy, and that you open it small and it slowly, it will build.
Crying game.
Give it a crying game. Give it a chance to build. They gave it no chance. They pulled it. And for me, it's tragic. It's the most beautiful, beautiful
and
movie.
And the story, tell the story. It's the story of two...
Well, it's almost very hard to tell. It's just two guys who are 75 years of age. Their life is gone behind them. Their life is finished. How are they going to survive the next couple of years? The boat without friends, they make a friendship. The two most unlikely people to be friends, and they make this friendship that is terribly moving and terribly touching.
And this is as good as your performance in the field. It's as your performance
in Sporting Life.
In Sporting
it's
Life,
it's as good as it's as good
and
as
either as good as anything Duvall has ever
Duvall
done.
Duvall says it's his best performance.
And he's so good that you think he is as good an actor as you have ever worked with.
I think he's the best actor I've ever worked with. And I've worked with Brando, and I've worked with Ali Guinness, and I've worked with Heston. I've worked with a lot of great actors. He's the best actor I've ever worked with. And this performance of his in the picture was an extraordinary.
And so when you go to the movie company and you say, how could you do this?
That's right.
Is a great film. This has got great performances.
That's right.
This could do it.
That's right. Give us a shot.
You screwed it up by doing this. And what do they say?
They say,
Richard, go to the Bahamas and shut up.
That's what they say. They say, don't take his phone calls. Don't take his calls.
And send him his check and tell him to be quiet.
It's a shame. It's just a shame.
Is there nothing that can be done?
Nothing, no.
Yeah. And what did the critics say about this film? Did they like it? Or did they agree with your assessment?
Well, first of all, let's talk about the people. When they had the test screenings, there were just a series of excellence, brilliance, right? A couple of fairs, the rest brilliances. They had the Los Angeles Times, the Washington Post and Chicago Times. I couldn't have written the reviews like it. I couldn't have written them myself. But in the week we opened for Academy Award qualifications, we had to open December in three cinemas, which was New York, Los Angeles, Toronto.
Right.
It was the same week the Biggies opened, and we were kind of put aside.
Yeah.
Schindler's List, obviously, we're going to lose. But we were put aside. And so the reviews, people kind of... the reviews were good for those, but they weren't boom as they should have been when we opened later in February, not in December, in the big, big, heavy week.
Right.
And
what if they'd held it for the summer of 1995?
It would play forever. The picture would play forever.
And does Duvall feel the same way?
He does,
he's in the front page, which is just, the paper, which is just opening.
He's distraught, and I am distraught, absolutely distraught that they didn't give it
and
a
chance.
And
this is a role you wanted to do. I mean, you just sort of had the script, and you plane lands,
well,
and
you
say...
actors, since my career has been up and down, in and out, and so forth, and it's always... And what happened was...
And we know who to blame for that.
We know who to blame for that. A guy called Richard Harris. But when you read it, a script talks to you. A script will, the character will say, play me.
In whose voice?
In God's.
Yes.
He'd say, play me, Richard, play me.
Play me, Richard.
And I got it and said, yes, I want to do it. And the tragedy is...
And you went to the director?
Yeah, no, I was way down the list.
Yeah. You were not the first choice.
No way. I was way down the list. And I said, test me. It'll be the performance of my lifetime. I guarantee you, test me. Will you test? I said, I'll test. I went to California, they tested me, I got the part.
Did you have to do something like this for the field as well?
Yeah, I did.
I mean, you're at the point in your life where you've got to...
Yeah, I got to prove it.
You got to prove it.
Hey, I got no. First of all, I got to prove I'm alive.
Yes, that's true.
I remember that the American.
Is that you, Richard? Yes.
That's right. I hadn't done the picture for 8 years before the field.
Yes.
And suddenly, and Noel Pearson and Jim Sheridan, right. The producer and director, called up the guy in California who's going to distribute and said, "We're going to cast Richard Harris." He said, "Richard Harris? I thought he was dead." Can you believe that?
Yeah. No, I don't think so.
And you know what kills you, really? You work so hard.
Stories of my death are exaggerated.
But you work so hard on a picture, preparing it, working on it. Yeah. I mean, Duvall spent months and months and months. I spent months before we even started to shoot. And you work so hard. You commit so much. And then it's gone. You think, oh, my God. That's the heartbreak.
But you went to the director and you said, "I want to do this part. Yeah. I'm made for this part. I'm going to do this part. I'll do anything."
Yeah, she ran the hens. She said, "I'll see you for 5 minutes."
Yeah.
So I dashed in, and 5 hours later, I really convinced her I should play.
And had Duvall already been chosen?
Yeah, he'd been cast, yeah. Yeah, I mean, they had to chase him. He had to make his mind up about it.
We're going to do this at a longer time, but do you, when you think of the good times you've had, the good times that you have had, any regrets? I mean, do you look at 50 films of which you say only three are really good?
Say about six.
Oh, six. Molly Maguire was good.
Yeah, and Camelot was good.
And Camelot was good.
I think, and Sporting Life was good.
Right.
Hemingway was good. Right. And who knows?
Yeah,
that's fine. There's a six there somewhere. Sorry.
For all the good time you had, for all the women and all the song and all of the drink, was it worth it?
Yeah. If I had my life to live again, I swear to God, I'd have drank the exact amount of vodka that I drank, which you can't
count. There are years you don't remember.
I know. And I would, but people keep telling me. And if they're telling me the truth of what I did, I can't remember it. It was a wonderful life.
Yeah, but what about those who say, "Richard, you had talent, you had gifts, you had..."
Yeah, but it can't live other people's lives. I mean, I've only one life, and I've lived it. And now, of course, having been in... And I did some great work. On the stage. The best work on the stage.
Really? Why is that, you think?
Well, about 3 years ago, I did the Pirandello, Henry IV, and I won every award in England that year. Everything. I swept the boards with the awards that year. Well, so I got a chance to come back and do it, and then I'll screw it up again, probably, but it doesn't matter. In the meantime, I'm going to be alive. And do you know what happened, Charlie?
What?
I went back. My brother died, about 4 weeks ago, my elder brother. And I went back to Limerick to the family tomb. We have a tomb, not a grave. And my great-great-grandfather is in there. And he was buried in 1880. And my great-great-grandmother was buried in 1885. And I walked in, and there was remnants still in this vault of their bits of their coffins. And inside that vault were my great-grandfather, great-grandmother, great-grandfather, grandmother, mother, father, two brothers, two sisters, and a niece. And I looked, and I said, "Why should..." And Richard, why? It's only a movie. Look at them. They're gone. We're here. Why? What the hell? Who worries? Live the life that you want to live. Have fun. This is not a rehearsal, Charles.
That's right.
This is not a rehearsal. This is it. This is the opening night.
Give it your best shot.
Give it the best shot.
Thank you for coming.
God
bless you. Great to
see you. Thank you for having me.
Abraham on April 3rd and 4th, I guess it is, on TNT.
That's right. Thank you. Thank you for having me.
We'll do this again.
I'd love that.
Kurt Masur is here, and I can't wait to talk to him. I know you'll enjoy it. Stay with us. Thank you. One of the world's greatest orchestras, the New York Philharmonic, has been under the direction of legendary figures such as Arturo Toscanini, Leonard Bernstein, and Zubin Mehta. But its newest music director, Kurt Masur, has taken this orchestra to an even higher level in only 2.5 years with innovative programming such as young people's concerts and rush hour concerts. He's building his audience as well, but that counts for only half of his work. He divides his time between New York and the Gowanda's Orchestra in Leipzig, Germany, and I am pleased to have him here. Welcome. Did I say that right? Help me say that.
Gewandhaus. It's very hard.
Gewandhaus.
Gewandhaus. Even for German people.
Now, speaking of German people, there was a story in the press about you possibly one day becoming president of Germany.
Yeah.
Tell me about that. Nothing to it?
No, nothing to it. At least it's a long history, because, as you know, the unification of Germany was already 3 years ago.
Right.
And at that time, as people were belonging to look for somebody they could trust,
right.
They just mentioned my name. It made me happy that they trusted me.
Right. But the role of the president of Germany is one that you could fill, I mean, because it is more of a figurehead, more of because the chancellor is actually the person who runs the country.
Who runs the country.
Yeah, so you stand for something.
Yeah, but on the other hand, look, von Weizsäcker is such a great man, and I admire him very, very much. I didn't like that he has to go away because of the law, the rules. And I wouldn't feel myself to be able to follow him. In the musical field, it's a different story. And I think I can do nearby the same, or even more in international terms.
In what way and how?
I mean, make people understanding.
Yeah.
Being a diplomat, being helping to bring the world together.
And using music as a common language.
Exactly.
Yeah. In fact, when the Gewandhaus Orchestra was here, how was that for you to have them here in the United States?
It was very exciting. You know, it was not our first touring. We started already in 1974, our first tour. And we have done more than 180 concerts already here. But after I have been the music director of New York Philharmonic, then coming, I knew exactly that everybody is watching and listening in another direction. And to compare and to see how does it sound with the same conductor, how does this orchestra sound with the same conductor. And it was a thrilling experience, I must say. But at the other hand, for me, it proved my experience before that American audience and New York Philharmonic are very fair listeners.
Fair listeners.
Yes.
Now, are there ever audiences that aren't fair listeners?
Oh, yes. Look, if you go...
Berlin.
Let's go to Vienna. Let's go to Vienna. Yes. Compare some other orchestra with Vienna Philharmonic. Everybody in Vienna says, our orchestra is the best.
Yeah.
And this is a different...
You're second.
Yeah.
By definition, our ears believe our orchestra in Vienna or in Berlin is the best.
So this, for my feeling, was the most exciting meeting with the same audiences we have met before. And this fairness and this openness was very, very convincing for me.
Now, here is what I understand, and you help me understand this, that what you have done with the Philharmonic is you have tamed this orchestra. You have come in, and you have been tough, and you have imposed discipline. And the members of the orchestra like that, but you had to do that. You have really brought something, and you have unleashed, by your taming of them, a whole new energy.
I believe we shouldn't try to find out that I made them more disciplined. I think the only thing what was in my mind, to inspire that orchestra that they each night like to play. And to inspire means you get discipline. But this is just besides. Because if everybody wants to play beautiful, and if everybody feels it makes sense to work hard, then you have discipline. And that's all. That's what I feel now.
So you have to give that orchestra, as the artistic director, you have to give them a desire to be as good as they can be.
Yeah, to inspire.
How do you do it?
They feel that I'm burning for the music I'm conducting. And to try to bring a very special and clear meaning, a meaningful play that the audience can understand what we mean or what the composer wanted to tell, what message we want to bring over. And this orchestra is technical, without limits. So they can do everything. And this what makes me really happy. I'm just coming from the dress rehearsal, and I must tell you, it's just amazing to play Schumann and Schumann's Second Symphony with such a European, wonderful sound, warm sound. This is very rare. And that New York Philharmonic can do that, besides the ability to play very virtuous and very brilliant. This is outstanding.
This is not what I think you have attempted to do, but people talk about this. Have you changed the sound of this orchestra?
No, I wanted to add something. Because for special things, they have their own sound. Yeah. So it happened as I rehearsed with the orchestra, West Side Story dances. They have done it with Lenny.
Yeah.
And I played it through, and I said, dear friends, what I discovered now, the best, you go home and rest, and I go home and study the score. So the point is that this orchestra in this certain style is so clear and so outstanding that we have not to talk about. I just can bring, in addition to that, more knowledge, more feeling for special middle European composers to make a difference between Brahms and Tchaikovsky style and how to play Schumann and so. And this is where I can help.
Yeah. Where do you put... Well, we've talked about it before, and I've had these conversations about, I mean, for a great conductor with a great art, you've got to, there are certain Brahms, Beethoven, Schumann?
Bruckner, Schumann.
Bruckner. You've got to have, that's the core
yeah.
of what you have to
yeah, sure.
create with.
Sure.
And then beyond that, you do what? You reach to...
We try to also to reach out, Mozart is very important, right. We will do more Haydn. So the whole field where you know the refinement of the orchestra can grow with this kind of classical pieces also, not only the romantic period, which they can play very beautiful also, but the refinement of the orchestra then leads also to refinement even in contemporary music. And there are composers which needed to be played like Mozart.
Now, aren't you doing something with film scores up there as well? What is that,
film
Prokofiev?
Prokofiev. We try to make our programs also very much alive. But the film scores are not the crucial point.
Okay. What's the crucial point?
Crucial point is really to work for each concert, also besides for the development for the future.
Yeah.
That the orchestra is sure in style in every decade. From Baroque time, from old music to the presence.
Yeah. Do you tell me about this?
Yeah.
Jeanne
d'Arc, this is one of the most impressive pieces by Honegger.
Right.
And I don't know how much the story of Jeanne d'Arc is known here. For instance, the kids if the in the schools
right.
it's taught. But this kind, and especially in the piece of Honegger, it comes out that this imagination of a young girl to save his country
yes.
and to try to look into the future. She was a dreamer, but what she achieved was to make France independent from England. And this was a kind of heroism she was not aware of. And this is such a touching story because she was burned at the end, so she was killed
right.
by those people who were saved by her, at least.
Yes.
And the end and the idea of the end that love will survive. Love will survive. So it means that people who have their activities in their life because they loved and because they loved the human beings, they will survive in the mind of the people.
What else are you doing in the coming season? What are you going to be? What's on your agenda?
I believe if we talk especially about the current week and then the next three
yeah.
weeks, 4 weeks of, for my test, outstanding programming.
Yeah.
Because tonight we are doing two pieces where connected through Schumann's fate. Schumann
right.
went mentally ill. And he has composed his second symphony after his first experience of being mentally ill and tried to recover with writing the symphony.
Yeah.
And Brahms wrote his first piano concerto after he experienced that Schumann wanted to make suicide.
Yeah.
And these are two pieces which are outstanding. Connected.
I'm unfortunately out of time, and it's always wonderful to have you here.
Mm-hmm.
You're close by. I hope you'll come anytime.
Sure.
I really would appreciate it. I mean, I you teach me and I learn more about music when I have you here than I ever would otherwise, and in preparing for it. I'm also fascinated by the nature of the relationship between a new artistic director and his orchestra and how he shapes it or how she shapes it. Great to see you.
Thank you very much.
Kurt Masur of the New York Philharmonic. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Major funding for Charlie Rose was provided by the people at DuPont, originators of products and ideas that make a difference in everyday life. DuPont, better things for better living. And by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and the annual financial support of viewers like you. Charlie Rose was also made possible by these funders. To order Charlie Rose program transcripts for $5 each and video cassettes for $29.95 each, call 1-800-825-5746 or write to Journal Graphics at the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.